So, having seen a number of examples of CW complexes, we return to the more elaborate study of topological properties of CW complexes. To start with a CW complex, X, then X power K is the kth skeleton, namely all union of all simplexes or all cells of dimension less than or equal to k, right? So this each skeleton xk is a closed subset of x. This is the first statement. The second statement is each closure cell is also a closure subset of x. This is not just a closed cell, it's not just a name, but it refers to closeness of the underlying set inside x. A subset S of X is closed if and only if S intersects each closed cell in EK, least closed cell EK of X in a closed subset of EK. The topology on X is compactly generated. So these are the four observations you want to make about the topology of a CW complex. Okay. Remember, a subset is closed in X if and only if it intersects each skeleton, okay, in a closed set. That is the definition of the topology on X. Right? If X is actually a skeleton, then we don't need this definition, because each skeleton XK is obtained by attaching K cells to XK minus 1. Therefore, the topology is well defined there as a quotient topology of a certain object. All right. So this definition, this statement A is needed only when X has infinitely many skeletons. The dimension of X is infinite. So first of all, each XA is a closed subset. How do you see that? Look at XK intersect with XL. If XK, K is smaller than L, it is just XK. If K is bigger than L, it is XL. So either it is XL or XK, they are closed subsets. This is what you have to show. Right? Then only each XK will be closed subset. If XK is a closed subset, if XK intersection XL, inside XK is a closed subset. Now, if XK is contained in XL, where L is bigger, then we know that XL is obtained by attaching cells to XK minus 1, XK plus 1, and so on. XL, XL minus 1, etc. So each Y, when you attach cells to Y to get X, we have seen that Y is a closed subset of X. Okay, so successively XK will be closed subset of XK plus 1, closed in XK plus 2, closed in XK and so on. XK will be closed in XL. If L is bigger than X, so you can interchange the two roles. Therefore, intersection of XK with every other thing is closed. Therefore, XK will be closed. Okay, so this much argument is needed here to say that XK is closed. Next one, each closed cell is a closed subset of X. To see that, I have to show, again, take a closed cell, say it is called as sigma, intersect it with each XK, okay, then it must be closed inside XK. If this cell, say cell itself is of a dimension, say L, all right? If K is bigger than L, it will already contain the entire sigma, right? And each closed cell is, we have seen, when we attach a cell, they take a L sigma is a dimension L, then it will be closed in XL, right? Once it is closed in XL, it will be closed in XL plus 1, XL plus 2, and so on, XK also. All right. So if L is smaller than K, it's fine. If L is bigger than K, what happens? Then the intersection, let us take a paragraph, sigma is of dimension K plus 1, and you are intersecting with XK. What is the intersection? Intersection is the boundary. And we have seen that the boundary is closed. Okay. So this way, you will show that each cell is also a closed subset of X. The next thing is, take a subset S. If it's closed, if and only if. One part is obvious. If it's closed, then the intersections are all closed. Because we have shown that EKs are all closed. Intersection of two closed sets is closed. Now we have to look at the corners. The corner S intersection EK is closed in EK. Right? But we want to show that S intersection XK is closed in XK for every K. Does that follow from this one? If this XK, if K and this one are same, for example, this EK is closed in XK. And so S intersection EK is closed in EK, and EK is closed in SK, so it's closed in XK also. Okay. So showing that X intersection, since S intersection XK is closed, will follow from, I mean, very easy, for it is closed in E, because this is EK is closed. Okay. So C also follows. Finally, D also follow for the following reason. What is this? What is the meaning of compactly generated? The same thing as instead of EK, I have to put a compact set for every compact set of X, original X. Take a set S such that S intersection K is closed in K. So this should be true for every compact set. Once this is true, S must be closed. Again, we have to show only this part. The other part, if S is closed, S intersection K will be closed in K, that is obvious. Okay. Take any compact set. We know that it is covered by what? Finitely many closed cells. Therefore, S intersection K will be the union of X intersection some sigma. The sigmas are finitely many of them. So union of finitely many closed sets will be closed. So S intersection sigmas are closed inside, actually in the whole of space. Therefore, they will be closed inside K. So S intersection K, which is union of finitely many of them, will be closed in K. Okay. And conversely, for each EK, you can show that actually that is what we wanted. For each EK is compact, is what we have seen already. For every compact set is closed, so in particular for each compact set also it will be closed. Okay. So all these things are written down carefully here. So let us go through this one once again. Okay, so first we want to say that the K skeletons are closed. Okay, so we have seen that if X is obtained by attaching K cell, then Y is a closed subset of. From here, it will follow that X naught is closed in X1, X1 is closed in X2, X2 is closed in XK, and so on. Therefore, each Xi is closed in Xi plus N, where N is any extra positive number. Okay. Therefore, if you reverse the role, either XK cross intersection XR is either XR where R is smaller or XK where K is smaller. So it will be closed subset. So part B, X naught being a discrete space, is Hausdorff. Okay, we have to take Hausdorffness. The Hausdorffness, the EKs are not close, need not be close. You remember that. By corollary, whatever we have earlier inductively, it follows that the skeleton XK is Hausdorff. This was one of the exercises. If Y is Hausdorff, by attaching a single dimension K cells, whatever you get is Hausdorff. Okay, so I am using that one here. That's why this will be, these things will be true. So each XK is Hausdorff. Now EK is a closed cell, then it is compact subset of XK. A compact subset of a Hausdorff space is closed. Since each XK is closed in X itself, we are done. So each EK is closed in XK. So this is an easy way of saying the whole thing, but you have to use to show that a closed cell is actually closed, you have to use the Hausdorffness of it. If a relative CW complex, then you should have started with Y as a Hausdorff space, then this will be true. Okay. The C part, I will repeat this one. Namely, I have to show that if S intersection E is closed for every E inside E, then S itself is closed, is what I have to show. Okay. Inductively, we will show that S intersection XK is closed in XK for every K. How S intersection SX0, X0 being a discrete space, every subspace is closed. So S intersection X0 is also closed inside. So there is nothing to prove. Suppose we have proved it for K, then we appeal to this lemma on S intersection XK plus 1 is a closed in XK plus 1. Remember, when you attach one single thing, what is the condition? It should be S intersect S. This set is closed if and only if S intersection XK is closed and S intersection each K plus 1 cell must be closed. And that is the condition here. So step by step, you'll get S intersection XK plus 1 is closed in XK plus 1 and so on. So that is part C. Okay. Now about compactly generatedness. Okay. So this is the meaning of co-indice topologies, compactly generated. Okay. A subset is closed in X if and only if S intersection K is closed for every compact system. If look at each cell E, it's compact. Therefore, by this condition, S intersection E is closed in E. By C, it will be closed in the whole of A. The converse is obvious. Okay. So now I come to this, why this finitely generated, there are only finitely many, etc. Why I gave that argument? That was the argument used in olden days. Not only that, this was put as a condition in the definition itself by J.H.C. Whitehead, who gave the first definition of CW complex. Okay, so I'll elaborate on that one a little bit later. Right now, once you have got this thing, if you have worked out for the attaching cell, the same exercise, if Y is Hausdorff, regular or normal, then X is Hausdorff, regular, normal. That's what I have given an exercise. Now, inductively, you can do that if A is a Hausdorff space, a regular space, or whatever it is, then so is X, where XA is a relative CW complex. In particular, every CW complex, E is a T4 space. So this is left as an exercise for you now. Having solved that exercise, this will be easier. The next one is, you should pay attention to this one. It's a very, very important result on CW complexes all the time used. Okay. So what is it? It just says that every CW complex, okay, is a disjoint union of its open cells. Don't be under the confusion that therefore it is disconnected, you may say. No, these open cells are just names. They are not open subsets of X. Not necessarily. Some of them may be, some of them are not. Indeed, they are open cells if they are maximal. That no additional cell of higher dimension will intersect their interior. Then only they are open cells. Open. But they are open cells. Therefore, open cells are by definition what? It is just the interior of DN, whatever, under the image of phi, that quotient map. So that is the open part there. Okay. It's open inside the closed cell, that's all. So what we are saying is, take all the interiors of these cells. That will be the union of the entire CW complex. This result, we have seen it in simplicial complexes. It's exactly same here. In fact, much simpler. What is it? By very definition, you can write X as X naught union X1 minus X0 union X2 minus X1 and so on. So XK minus XK minus 1. Right? This union is periodic union because XKs are increasing subspaces of X. Here in this notation, I have taken X minus 1 is empty set. We start with X0. There is nothing to subtract. X naught is the union of zero cells, and zero cells are both open and closed. So all these points belong to this disjoint union, right? So we start with all the zero cells, they are open cells. Okay, now look at X1 minus X0. What are they? They are open one cells and they are disjoint. Any two open one cells are always disjoint. Okay. So XK minus XK minus 1, more generally, is the disjoint union of open K cells. Take any K cell, its boundary is contained inside XK minus 1. And you are throwing away that. What you left out is its interior. Okay, so this is a totally obvious statement, but this is a very useful one. Now let us see how it is useful. This lemma says, take a subset that contains at most one point from each open cell. At most one point. Intersection of an open cell and S is a singleton or empty set. So this is the condition on S. Such a set is closed automatically and discrete subset of X. Okay, if you think a little bit, it is obvious. But now let me write down the full proof of this one. Okay, there are books and books which give you long proofs of this one. So even myself, I got this proof only a little later. And then there I found out that there are books which I have written like this also. To show that S is a closed set, what you have to do? Intersect with each XK and show that it's closed inside XK. Start with X naught. X naught is a discrete space. Every subset is closed. That's fine. Now assume that S intersection xk is closed in xk. I have to show that S intersection xk plus 1 is closed in xk plus 1. Right? That's what I have to show. Then for any closed k plus 1 cell E, look at k plus 1 cell, E intersection S either is inside xk or it's in the interior of E. If it's in the interior of E, S intersection that part is at most one point. Right? Therefore, if you look at E intersection S, it will have at most one extra point than E intersection S intersection XK. In either case, this is a closed subset of XK plus 1. Because this is already closed in XK plus 1, what I get is one extra point. So it's a closed subset. Therefore, S intersection XK plus 1 is closed in XK plus 1 by our lemma. Because xk plus 1 is got by attaching k cells to k plus 1 cells to xk. Okay, intersection with, say, this, you take this as y, this intersection is closed, and with each k plus 1 cell it's closed. Either it is empty in the interior or one extra point will come. Therefore, it's closed subset. Remember, this is a Hausdorff space. So adding one extra point is a closed set because each point is a closed subset. Okay. Therefore, it will be closed in xk plus 1. So this way, S intersection xk will be closed for every k. Therefore, S is closed. So what we have shown, S with that special property, namely, it contains only one extra one point or no points from each interior of each cell, such a property automatically is closed. Now take any subset of S. It will have also same property. Right? Therefore, every subset of S is closed. If every subset is closed, every subset is open also, that's a discrete space. Okay, so such a set is discrete as well as a closed set. We can use this one to prove certain property that I was telling you, that about finitely many cells and so on, that comes now very easily. Okay, take any compact set K of a CW complex. It is contained in the union of finitely many open cells. The funny thing is, these open cells may not be an open cover. They don't form an open cover because they are not open subsets, not necessarily. Yet, a compact set is contained in a finitely many open cells. This is an easy consequence of the previous lemma. Okay, X itself is a union of open cells. Therefore, every set inside it is contained in the union of open cells. Right? You start with a compact set. Suppose you need infinitely many open cells to cover it. That means what? That means there will be infinitely many points, you know, infinitely many cells which will intersect K on empty intersection. Pick up one point from each of these cells, open cells. Only one point you pick up, which is common with K. Then what will be the property of this K, this subset? That subset has the same property as previous lemma. But it is a subset of K. The previous lemma says that that subset is discrete, but it is a subset of K. K is compact. A discrete subset of a compact set is finite. So you couldn't have infinitely many points like that. Okay, so I repeat, if not, what happens? K will intersect infinitely many open cells, which we know are disjoint. Therefore, I can select one point in each such intersection. We will get a subset S of K, which is by lemma, it's a discrete subset of a compact set. But by the very choice, S is infinite. That is not possible. Okay. So this is the consequence. Closure of every cell, which we know is compact now, okay, meets only finitely many open cells, because every compact set intersects only finitely many open cells. This property, closure meeting finitely many open cells, was called closure finite property. Okay. So this is the remark I wanted to make. I am going to elaborate it on. I was all the time referring to. The property of CW complex is known as closure finiteness. Okay, that means what? Closure of every cell will meet only finitely many open cells. Okay. So this explains the presence of the letter C. CW complex. This C was corresponding to the closure finiteness in this mysterious nomenclature of CW complex. The CW complex was the name given by the creator, J.H. Whitehead, creator of this concept. Historically, this property was an additional part of the definition itself. J.H.C. White's definition of CW complex was very, very long. He had put many of the standard properties which we are discussing now as a consequence in the definition itself. Okay, so this was one of the properties, closure finiteness. We have just proved that we don't need to put this extra condition in the definition. By the way, there is W. What is this W corresponding to in the letter CW? C corresponds to closure finiteness. What is W? W corresponded to the weak topology, the compactly generated topology. Okay, that's also called weak topology. Okay, corresponds to weak topology on it. So it might have been appropriate to call this one. There is no need to W. There is no need for C. We have seen, but W is not this weakness. The compactly generated or co-induced topology, that part is necessary. Therefore, we could have just added C and kept only W. We can set W complexes, but nobody has made that kind of suggestion. So I am alone perhaps. So let us not stick to a new nomenclature. Let us not create a new nomenclature here. Let us, many people just call, they have given up W also, but now they are calling it a cell complexes, made up of cells. So that is a good name. Cell complex is a good name. Okay. But I would say that you better stick to CW complex, because there are many notions of cell complexes. Each author has his own definition, and sometimes they just differ slightly. Like somebody doesn't put Hausdorff names, somebody puts something else and so on. And the structure also somewhat different. So let us not bother about new terminology. Let's call it as a CW complexes. Okay, so is that closure finiteness property? If you read old papers, then what you will get is this kind of definition. The closure finiteness is a consequence, all right, of actually the fundamental thing is the quotient space structure here. Okay, attaching cells gives you X as a quotient space. And then from x1, x2, x3, one contains other, x infinity, namely x itself, has the topology co-induced by these inclusion maps. You could have taken directly that compactly generated, but before defining compactly generated, you have to have topology on it. So you can't say that compactly generated. So all these problems, CW complex, in Bifrand DW complex, you know, though he had the ideas, things were not available to him. So many of these things were developed much later. So it was a great invention after all. So let me go ahead with the topology in the spirit of our earlier lemma of extending the neighborhoods so that their deformation retracts and so on. Remember that lemma. Remember that proposition. Okay. So I am going to make another such lemma here, which will be useful later in the study of CW complexes. What does it say is the following. Start with the CW complex. For each n, let Vn be a neighborhood of Xn inside Xn plus 1. Okay. Let X be a point in the interior of a, say, some K cell. And Wk be an open neighborhood of X inside sigma. Okay. Choose some small epsilon neighborhood, for example, W. Some neighborhood of X inside sigma. So you can, by the way, here also you can say open everywhere, open neighborhood, no problem. Then there exists a open neighborhood W of X in X such that W intersection XK is WK and W intersection XN is contained in VN for all N. So this WK, which is an open subset of open neighborhood of X inside sigma, gets extended to W. Extended means what? Intersected with XK is WK, is exactly equal to WK. And it's controlled in the sense that intersection with XN is contained inside VN. It's not becoming too big. This W is a neighborhood of X in X itself. A neighborhood WK, which is inside XN plus 1, sorry, where is it? Inside WK, inside XK, may not be open inside X. Okay, it's like you have a point on the line and a neighborhood of that point on the line, like an interval. But now interval is contained inside R2. That interval is not open inside R2, but you can extend it to a square, open square. And that is precisely what we have done in the first lemma. We took any subset of the boundary, and then we extend it to a neighborhoods of that inside the disk, right? And this fundamental, you know, elementary construction is going to help us in all this. So this is the lemma that we had. Okay, starting with attaching cells. Okay, start with a subset A, where is it? B inside Y. The B gets thickened to N epsilon B. Okay, this epsilon could be chosen at your will. And that is a neighborhood, that's an open subset of X. Okay. And if you intersect it with the Y, then it is just B itself. So it is extended. Q, B is PQ, it's a strong differentiator. This part is extra thing. We don't need this one right now. Okay, this is also true we can do, but all that I want is extension from, not from Y to X, not from XK to XK plus 1, but XK to directly to X we want now. So we have to do inductive steps. So this theorem is what we are going to use. Okay. So now I have to go back, but this is not where I am to go. So by this proposition, for each k plus 1 cell tau, okay, tau intersection vk plus 1 is open subset in tau contained in the entire boundary of tau. Because what are vn's? Vn's are neighborhoods of xn. So they contain the boundary of any simplex, n plus 1 simplex. Boundary of any n plus 1 simplex is xn. So it's contained in Vn. When you take the inverse image, it will be contained in the entire the boundary, in a boundary sphere. So I am not going above at all. I am just working on in X itself all the time. So the notations, etc., are simpler here. Okay. So for each k plus 1 cell tau, tau intersection V k plus 1 is an open subset of tau, containing the entire boundary, which is actually a subset of xk and contained inside vk plus 1. Therefore, we can choose epsilon to epsilon tau such that once the entire sphere is there, which is compact, there will be an epsilon. If it's non-compact, then there would have been a problem. So A tau is equal to n epsilon of tau dot. Remember this, what is the meaning of tau dot? Tau dot is a subset, is a sphere itself actually. N epsilon of tau dot is contained inside tau intersection vk plus 1. This happens for every tau. So there I have to have, you know, sigma, alpha, and so on. I reduce the notation here, that's all. Okay. Therefore, if you take b tau, which is equal to a smaller set, namely n epsilon tau dot intersection with wk, that will be a subset of tau intersection vk plus 1. Okay, so this itself is intersection tau, this itself is in tau intersection vk plus 1. I am taking a subset here by taking the intersection of this one. Okay, so this is going to be an open subset. Therefore, n epsilon of that will be open subset. This is the import of this lemma. Okay. So take wk plus 1 to be the union of all these b taus as done in the proposition. If you take union of all these b taus, that is going to be an open neighborhood of this x, because x is there anyway, in xk plus 1. That will be an open subset of xk plus 1. So it's an open neighborhood of xk plus 1. Okay, and its intersection with xk is precisely wk, because all these neighborhoods had this one. B, remember, B is equal to qb is equal to what? It's intersection of n epsilon b intersection with y. So that is the meaning of wk plus 1 xk equal to wk. And wk plus 1 is a union of all these b tau's. It is contained inside vk plus 1. So inductive step is over. Okay. Now what you do? You just take W equal to. So we have what is inductive step for all of them. Now you just take W equal to union of all the Wn's. You start with n greater than or equal to k here. You start with Wk because x happens to be inside the k cell, in the interior of k cell. If x is a vertex, if x is zero cell, you would have taken all these things n greater than or equal to zero. Okay. Why this is open? Intersection with each xn is a neighborhood open subset, wn minus. Intersection with xn is this one. Why it is contained vn plus 1? But if you have W and intersection, it's precisely so, it's contained in Vn. That's how we have chosen. So this is controlled by these Vn's, but it's a neighborhood of X inside X itself. okay? So this I call it as controlled extension. So we will use this one much later, of course, but we will use that. All right. So we have done quite a bit of topology, but there are many more things to be done. One of the most important thing is that the CW complexes, the weak topology is very, very useful in constructing continuous functions on CW complexes. So this was the motivation for taking that. Or verifying, suppose you have constructed something, verifying that it's a continuous. Defining a continuous function, as well as if there is a function to verify a continuous function, the CW complex structure is very useful. Whereas if you take just an arbitrary space and so on, like R infinity and so on, it would be very unwieldy to do that kind of things on that. In particular, we will show that there are lots of continuous functions, namely what is called as partition of unity. That we will discuss next time. So today, this is over. Thank you.